This is chapter 3, respiratory or respiratory. And I'm going to do the same thing. Just for efficiency's sake, I've already written everything up on the board so that I'm just going to highlight stems. I'm going to highlight drug classes, drug classifications, and then the order in which I put them. The first section we're going to talk about are antihistamines. And you divide antihistamines in first and second generation. There's controversy over whether there's a third generation. Drugs like fexofenadine, which is Allegra, is one that might be in the third generation. A third generation drug would be something that's maybe a metabolite or one of the isomers of the racemic mixture. So I'm not going to go into a third generation. First and second is enough for just our purposes right now. So antihistamines, H1, first generation is diphenhydramine. And again, we have this non-alphabetical order, so I'll put an ABC with a slash and then ABC with an arrow here to explain why. So we begin with first generation diphenhydramine. Diphenhydramine is in that generation that was first invented, and these made people very drowsy. You can see B, E, and D in Benadryl, so you can think of bed. And you can also see the DRY because it's drying, helps with allergy symptoms. But diphenhydramine, that's first generation, that goes through the blood-brain barrier, makes someone drowsy. Second generation, on the other hand, cetirizine and loratadine, so Zyrtec and Claritin, these don't cause the drowsiness because they can't get through the blood-brain barrier or they can't stay through the blood-brain barrier. And loratadine has a stem. It's A-T-A-D-I-N-E. And I know spelling has been de-emphasized since I was a kid, so I'm a Gen Xer. I was clapping erasers and had chalkboards and things like that. But in drug names, spelling is incredibly important because you pronounce loratadine the same as you pronounce famotidine. And the T-A-D-I-N-E, and the actual stem is A-T-A-D-I-N-E, sounds just like the tidine in the H2 blockers. But if you spell it T-I-D-I-N-E by accident, you've just made this drug, instead of for allergies, for acid, and we don't want to do that. So paying attention to spelling is very important with these medications. So cetirizine, Zyrtec, this T-I-R in cetirizine is pronounced tear, so you can think of tearing from allergy eyes. Loratadine has the adidine stem. The Claritin Clear commercials have been very clear about what it's for. You see people outside having fun on the picnic. You even look at the box. It's a blue sky. So Claritin Clear for allergies. But what I want to talk about also is this loratadine D. So what is that D? Well, D is for decongestant, and that decongestant is pseudoephedrine. So pseudoephedrine is brand name Sudafed, and you'll see it as loratadine D or Claritin D. Okay. And what's the rationale for that? Well, if you have allergies and nasal congestion, if you just use loratadine or Claritin, it's not going to help. But if you use loratadine with a decongestant, then it'll take care of the allergy symptoms and the decongestion. This decongestant pseudoephedrine, or Sudafed, is actually BTC. It's behind the counter. You have to show ID for it. This RIN, or DRIN, I think, is the stem. And because it's behind the counter, there's a certain amount that any person can get in a single day, a certain amount you can get in a month, because the pseudoephedrine can be used to make methamphetamine or meth. But one of my students said, I'm so fed up with being congested, and that's how you remember pseudoephedrine or Sudafed. So what we're doing to remember these is we start over the counter with these antihistamines and this decongestant. And what we're going to do is we're going to go into the nose. So we're physically thinking, okay, we're in the nose now. And phenylephrine is the PE in many oral liquids. Okay? And it's very similar to pseudoephedrine, except this one is not regulated. You can get as much of it as you want. The brand name for the nose one is neosinephrine. And then another one, which can be used in the nose, another decongestant, is oxymetazoline, which is Afrin. And this nasal spray you should really only use for 3 days. Okay. Otherwise, you might get some kind of rebound congestion. Okay. So we're staying in the nose, and that's how we're, you know, just like in the GI chapter, we went from stomach down to intestines. We're staying in the nose, and then we'll go down to the chest. So we have triamcinolone, and this lone some people use as a way to remember that it's a steroid. It's not a proper stem. The brand name, the CORT, stands for corticosteroid, and NASA for nose. Again, it's not a stem. You can't have a stem in a brand name. But these are hints that let you know what it's for. But allergic rhinitis, you have an itis, so that means you have an inflammation. So inflammations, we can use some kind of steroid. Okay? So for the first group here, we're starting with antihistamines, then we go to the decongestant, then allergic rhinitis, but being very mindful of where we are in the body. Okay? So we're going to go from the nose to then cough, which is going to be in the chest. So just as we've done before, we're going to go from an OTC to a prescription, and this is where we make our jump. Everything before just now was over the counter or behind the counter. So guaifenesin is a mucolytic, and some people get that confused because they've seen Robitussin for cough so long, but the guaifenesin is actually just M-U-C-O-L-Y-T-I-C. A mucolytic is something that breaks up mucus or breaks up chest congestion. The stem is in dextromethorphan, but you may never see that word. You might just see the DM. Okay, so guaifenesin with dextromethorphan is Robitussin DM. There's also Mucinex DM, either one of those. But the orphan stem is the one that tells you it's dextromethorphan. If the cough doesn't subsist, and maybe you go to the prescriber and say, you know, I've had this cough for a week and it's just not going away, it's not productive, they might prescribe something like codeine. Now, in the United States, codeine, you can't just get it over the counter. You used to be able to get a little bit, but now it's regulated. And that Chiritussin, the chair is for cherry, and then AC. Some people just use anti-cough, but I think and codeine was probably what it stood for. Okay? And then Tussin, an antitussive, is something that's for cough. So if that cough doesn't go away and you still have that chest congestion, if the prescriber is being very aggressive, maybe they'll treat the inflammation in the chest, and they'll do that with a steroid, with either methylprednisolone or prednisone. And again, we're staying with our alphabetical within the class of steroids. And methylprednisolone, this is an infix. So in English, we can have something that's a prefix before. We can have a suffix, which is at the end. Or we can have an infix, and infixes are extremely rare in English, but they're not rare when it comes to medications. So the pred, not the lone, is what tells you it's a prednisone type steroid, but some people still use that lone or sone as their cue, but really the stem is that pred. So maybe we go from the chest and we stay in the chest and stay in the lungs. And in the lungs, we're going to talk about these asthmatic medications. And so we have budesonide, and we pronounce this S-O-N, not as sun, but as sown. And I'm not going to underline it because it's not a proper stem, but some people still use it to recognize this is the steroid part. And I put fluticasone, this sone, underneath it, because these two drugs are doing the same thing. They're long-acting steroids that are going to be inhaled. So we have the steroid part of it for asthma. And then we also have I put beta 2 here. A beta 2 agonist is a bronchodilator. It's going to open up your lungs. And the stem for that is terol, T-E-R-O-L, T-E-R-O-L. You're probably most familiar with albuterol. Okay? But in these long-acting versions, formoterol and budesonide come together to make Symbicort. So they're symbiotic together, working together with a corticosteroid. And then fluticasone is working together with salmeterol to give you air, or you're adding them together, spelling add AD instead of ADD, to get air. Fluticasone, you can find it alone. And what I did was, where these are combination medicines, I just staggered this. I put a hanging indent where the fluticasone is on this side under the steroids and the albuterol is on this side, just to show you that I'm just separating this out. Where these are long-acting, this is long-acting, but this is a little bit more short-acting. So fluticasone comes as Flonase for the nose, but also as Flovent if you're going to use it orally. Okay. And then this albuterol is that rescue inhaler that most people are familiar with. What I did here was I put prophylaxis before acute. So our healthcare system is really treat once something's happened, but ideally you don't get asthma attacks because you take these long-acting medications, but sometimes you might have a breakthrough asthma attack and you would want that rescue inhaler, the beta-2 agonist albuterol. So I kept with that alignment. So albuterol, the terol, is under here in another combination product. But here we have tropium, and tropium is an anticholinergic. The chol, C-H-O-L, is about acetylcholine, and acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter we're talking about. Ipratropium does a really good job with asthma as well, and this comes in the medication Duoneb, literally two, a duo, that can be nebulized. Okay? And so albuterol works as a bronchodilator, ipratropium as well, and they work in concert together. Tiotropium also has this tropium stem to let you know that it's an anticholinergic, but this one is a little bit more long-acting than this short-acting one. And tiotropium is a long-acting anticholinergic, and this brand name is Spiriva. And if you think of the word respire or respiration, you see the S-P-I-R in there. But it's the tropium stems that let you know this is an anticholinergic medication. Okay. So again, now we've gone from, then just using some of the cognitive tools to go from over-the-counter to RX. We're going from a cough, which is in the chest, to the lungs, which is in the chest, and asthma. And then we're going to go on from these medications to three other medications that can be used in asthma incidents and things like that. The leukotriene inhibitor, montelukast, the stem leukast, seems an awful lot like leukotriene. It's given once a day, and that's where that single comes from in singular. And then if you're an asthmatic and it's helping your condition, then the AIR, A-I-R, is what helps. Anti-IgE antibody, so again, one of these biologics, omalizumab. So the mAb tells you it's a monoclonal antibody. And then LI and ZU also have meaning. I won't go into it here, but it's in the book. And it's important to understand with the biologics, we're going to have these complex stems telling us where it's from. And that's Xolair. And that, to me, that just sounds like extra air. So again, a way to remember that it's for asthma, but this is an injectable. The one thing with omalizumab is that it can cause anaphylaxis, so you always have to have somebody around when it's being injected. An epinephrine or an EpiPen is what you would use. Okay. So epi means above, neph means kidney. So above the kidney, what's above the kidney? The adrenal gland. So epinephrine is an injectable that does something very similar to the adrenal gland, which is secrete epinephrine. There's another word that's also called, that's very similar, and I'll just put it here. It's called adrenaline. And this is the Latin version. So ad means above or to, towards. And then renal means kidney. And then so this is the Roman or the Latin. And then this is the epinephrine is the Greek. Okay. But that's the respiratory medications in a nutshell.